Hello there. My name is Dr. Anton Jessup, proud Miskatonic University graduate, proponent of vivisection, and of course, curator of monster studies here at the university. Now, you've probably noticed that I am single, and will likely remain that way for some time because, you see, I am what is called a gorgonophile. Now, I imagine you remember Gorgons from Greek mythology, or at the very least, you remember that most famous of Gorgons, Medusa. Ah, Medusa. I have long held a torch for that monstrous vixen, and her curious anatomy is never far from my imagination. The Gorgon boasts a number of impressive and deadly features with which to dispatch its prey. The piercing tusks, the bloodletting claws. But the name Medusa likely summons other images for you, such as the flowing mane of vipers she calls her hair, her slithering, serpentine body, and most of all, oh, how you cower at the thought of her petrifying gaze. It's safe, you can look. Video's as good as a mirror, after all. Watch her move. Watch her kill. According to the myths of old, murderous Perseus finally beheaded our lovely Medusa. Ah, but her two sisters, Theno and Euryale, escaped into the underworld unscathed. So there's hope for us Gorgon lovers after all. But I know what you're thinking. Surely such an outrageous creature has no place among real-world organisms. Well, let's take a moment then to strip away the outright impossible and consider just what could exist in the light of the natural world. Let's start with the Gorgon's luxurious hair of squirming serpents, which aren't serpents at all. There's no conceivable evolutionary reason for such mimicry with an apex predator. These appendages coiled among more human-looking locks of hair are, of course, tentacles. Ah yes, tentacles aren't just for spineless mollusks. Vertebrates get in on the action too. Just consider the tentacle snake of Southeast Asia. Yes, tentacle snake. It uses its twin appendages to detect minute water movements in its environment. And then there's the star-nosed mole of North America. This subworlder boasts an array of 22 tentacles, each with 25,000 touch receptors to provide the best sense of touch among all mammals, enabling the star-nosed mole to gorge itself on subterranean worm hunts. I theorize the Gorgon uses its serpentine appendages for similar purposes, whether hunting down mercenaries in its lair or perhaps preying on revelers in a dark, crowded club. Its place is the underdark, its place is the shadows, so it needs supreme sensory domination of its habitat. As for the petrifying gaze, there's nothing in the natural world to suggest its victims literally turn to stone. I would wager the Gorgon merely hypnotizes its prey with pulsating colors rather than turning anyone into an impossible block of stone. The cuttlefish uses just such a tactic, manipulating the chromatophores in its flesh to dazzle the intended prey just long enough to snatch it up. So there are at least two Gorgons left in the world, more if they reproduce asexually. So I will continue to save myself for one of them. And you, perhaps you would like to date the other one. We could double date. It would be fabulous, just like in the movies. Sadly, I must go now. But in the meantime, I hope that you'll let me know what other fabulous creatures you would like for me to vivisect for you. I look forward to hearing from you in transmission.